In the Bible about the ending of the age, and one thing that's for certain, it grows closer every day. But I am not concerned about the way it's gonna end, 'cause I've read the back of the book and we win. Yes, I've
read the back of the book and we win. No more living in darkness, we'll be living at home.
You see, there ain't no need to worry about it if you're born again. Oh,
I've read the back of the book and we win.
Folks, it doesn't matter what the newspaper says. The back of the book says we win. Listen, now we all want to be winners in the games of life that we play. But friends, since I'm a sinner, I've already lost the race. But here's some real good news. Jesus' blood can take my sin, throw it in a deep blue sea. He can put an end to my last place living, give me the victory. Now I can sing,
I've read the back of the book and we win.
We win.
No more living in darkness, we'll be living at home with him.
You see, there ain't no need to worry about it if you're born again. No,
I've read the back of the book and we win.
Well, I've
read the back of the book and we win.
We win.
No more living in darkness.
Are you glad that Southern gospel music is back in San Diego, California? Let me hear you right now. All right. We're here to celebrate the strength of Jesus in our lives. He is our strength. Listen.
Strong in the strength of someone else, trusting a hand that never has failed, living a life of spiritual wealth. Strong in the strength of someone else, strong in the strength of someone else. I'm strong in the strength of someone else, trusting a hand that never has failed.
But he found a strength that was stronger than the lion. It was making the church out of that lion's den.
David stepped out to battle Goliath. Incredible odds said he could not win. But he found a strength that was stronger than the giant. With a sling and a stone, David's battle was won.
Strong in the strength of someone else, trusting a hand that never has failed.
Oh, I'm
living a life of spiritual wealth.
I am
strong in the strength of someone else. Strong in the strength of someone else.
I'm living in a world that's filled with evil. Incredible odds say I cannot win. But I found a strength that is strong like a mountain, the flowing through
someone else.
Yes, I am.
Trusting a hand that never has failed.
Oh, I'm
living a life of spiritual wealth.
I am
strong in the strength of someone else. Strong in the strength of someone else.
In sickness and health,
I'm strong in the strength. For richer or poorer,
I'm strong in the strength.
Death cannot bar this cause.
Trusting a hand that never has failed.
Oh, I'm
living a life of spiritual wealth.
Yes, I am
strong in the strength of someone else. Strong in the strength of someone else.
I'm strong in the strength of someone else.
Strong in the strength of someone else.
Account in the Bible how Peter and the disciples went out for a little boat ride, but on the way to the other side a great storm came up and the strong winds blew, but along came Jesus to the rescue. Peter was the one to take the leap of faith. I believe I hear Peter say,
you gotta go stepping out on the water. You gotta get out of the boat.
You gotta come
leave the shore and come out of the safety of your comfort zone.
You'll never learn how to swim if you never get wet. So launch into the deep and put your faith to the test.
You gotta go stepping out on the water. Trust the Lord.
Now take a look at your situation. Are you drowning in a sea of complications? You've got it way over your head. And you wonder if the storm will end. Well, if it's over your head, it's gotta be under his feet. Remember, God is able to supply all your needs. Miracles happen when you trust and pray. Pretty soon you will be able to say,
you gotta go stepping out on the water. You gotta get out of the boat.
You gotta come,
leave the shore and come out of the safety of your comfort zone.
You'll never learn how to swim if you never get wet. So launch into the deep and put your faith to the test.
You gotta go stepping out on the water,
and trust the Lord.
The moral of this little song is Jesus is the master of every storm. So when you feel the winds moving, I know you will find he may not come when you want him, but he's right on time.
You gotta go stepping out on the water.
Yeah.
You gotta get out of the boat.
Then you've got to come.
Leave the shore and come out of the safety of your comfort zone.
You'll never learn how to swim if you never get wet. So launch into the deep and put your
faith to the test. Stepping out, stepping out. You gotta go stepping out on the water,
and trust the Lord.
Trust the Lord.
Well, thank you so much. It's a joy to be at Shadow Mountain. We circled a few cities in our calendar that we really wanted to come our first year, and San Diego, El Cajon was one of those cities, and we just want to thank you so much for coming out and making this such a successful night. We were afraid it was just going to be us and about three people out here tonight. But you have made it an incredible evening. My goodness. The reason that you see Legacy 5 standing before you is because of the Cathedral Quartet. You know that that is our history. I was with the Cathedrals for 20 years. Scott was there for 10 years. And everything that we have as far as our music ministry, George and Glenn gave to us. And we will always honor them and always respect what they have done, not only in our lives, but in so many of the lives that gospel music has today. They gave us a year to put this group together. They came to us in November of 98 and said, guys, we've decided we're going to do a year's farewell tour, and we're going to say goodbye, and at the end of the year, that'll be it. You guys need to get you a quartet put together. Roger, Scott, need to hire a bass singer, baritone, a tenor, get a bus, buy a sound system, get some suits, record a couple of records, and see if you can book El Cajon, California. We thought that a year would be just more than enough time, you know, but it started turning quickly, and we started the auditions process, and here's what we found. We think we found us a pretty fair bass singer, did we not? Are you glad to see? His name is Glenn Dustin. He is from West Monroe, Louisiana. And got some people that's heard of West Monroe. It's about the only good thing that's ever come out of West Monroe. Of course, this coming from the man from Arkansas. Our gift to the nation for the last 8 years. Glenn is 31 years old. He's just the greatest young bass singer we've heard in so many years. He is doing an incredible job with us. Now, he looks really good. If the camera zooms in on him, you're going to see he's a nice-looking young man, nice smile there, and good expensive suit he's got on that we bought for him, brand-new cowboy boots we didn't buy. But you know what? Glenn hadn't traveled much before he joined Legacy 5. He's a country boy, and there's nothing wrong with that. But one of the funnier stories that I've heard his folks tell me about him that's very true, you've got to know. Glenn went to Washington, D.C. when he was in high school to sing for President Ronald Reagan. They took the whole choir, went to Washington, and Glenn was all excited, but he'd never traveled. His choir director told him, said, guys, don't take cash up there to that big city. Somebody could knock you in the head, steal your money, it'd be gone, that'd be it. You need to take traveler's checks. Well, the problem was, Cuz didn't know what a traveler's check was.
No idea.
He asked the teacher, and she said, well, go to the bank, and they'll tell you. Well, he's a Baptist boy. He had on his Bethel Baptist Church softball T-shirt.
Looking good.
Walked into the bank that afternoon, slapped his money down on the counter, and said, I'd like me some traveler checks, please. The lady said, what denomination? Einstein said, Southern Baptist. Well, I tell you what, when you get to heaven, they won't ask to see no traveler's checks, but you might need some traveling shoes to get there. Listen to this new song about that.
I'm gonna put on my traveling shoes one day, step on the clouds of my Lord.
I'm gonna
shake off my troubles and fly away. You won't believe how far.
My destination's heaven and I'm ready to go.
And I've got too much to gain to lose.
When the trumpet sounds, I'm gonna put on my traveling shoes.
Yes, this road I was walking on was dusty and long, and it was getting me nowhere fast. Jesus, and he beckoned to me and said, come to me, I'll give you rest. But lately I've been thinking about moving again, heading to my heavenly home. I've been walking through those gates and down those golden streets before the world even knows I'm gone.
I'm gonna put on my traveling shoes one day, step on the path of my Lord.
I'm gonna
shake out my troubles and fly.
Sounds like our tenor singer might be warmed up. This would be a good time to introduce him to you. Tonight, Tony, you've just been singing like incredible. And it's amazing. If you enjoy Tony Jarman, after he gets through singing, I want you to let him know it, however way you choose. If you don't like his singing very much, you sit there and stare at him like you have been me all night.
About us, never
Tony, wonderful job. Man. Well, I love the idea of we'll understand it all by and by. Tony, somehow I had forgotten about that song. And to be honest with you, when you started singing it, it brought back so many memories for me, not only because of the words, but the heart in which you sing. I just love to hear you sing. Did you really enjoy Tony Jarman? Give him one more nice one. I thank you. Thanks for making him feel so welcome, and all of the young guys. Scott and I knew what to expect when we came here because we've been here so many times, but we tried to tell the new guys in our group what to expect when they came to Shadow Mountain, and I don't think our words got told. You have been so wonderful to them, and thank you for that. I found that the older I get, the less I really know. I'm just being honest with you, you know. A lot of people think that with age comes a mantle of wisdom, and that's not necessarily the case. I am just as confused and muddled at 41 as I was at 21, you know. But I can tell you what I have learned. I have learned that Jesus is faithful. I have learned that God is sovereign. And I have learned that nothing takes him by surprise. I had a little tough week this week. My dad, Thursday of last week, had to have a heart cath, and he'd had some chest pains, and just as a fluke, they found out that he needed to have this heart cath. And Thursday afternoon, about 4 o'clock, my mom calls me and said, "Your dad's going in for open heart surgery in the morning, and I know you're getting ready to leave for an 11-day California trip. Is there any way you can come and be with us? I'm an only child, and my folks needed me really bad." And so I called Scott, and I said, "Scott, I need to stay." And so the guys left without me, and I drove through the night to Arkansas. It took me, got there about after midnight, and got there early to the hospital just in time to see my dad for about 20 minutes before he went in for the surgery. And we were joking around, and everything was great. And he went through the surgery fine, and he came back out that evening and was back in his room, which is an amazing thing to me. The heart surgery seems so routine almost now. And he was doing well, and suddenly he started slipping away mentally. Physically, he was fine. The heart was perfect. The sugar was perfect. The rate of the pulse was perfect. But mentally, all of a sudden, it was like a thick curtain descended down over my dad's brain. And between me and him, he didn't know who I was that afternoon. He didn't know anyone. They said, "Well, this is called ICU psychosis. Men his age gets it, and he'll be out of it by in the morning. Everything will be fine." Well, he just kept getting worse and worse. And he wasn't fine in the morning. And as of today, it's been a week and a day, and my dad is still basically unconscious and doesn't know where he is. And I got to tell you, I've been through a lot of tough times in my life. I've had financial setbacks. I thought were major at the time. My wife and I have had little tiffs and arguments. She finds it hard living with perfection. And y'all need to put her on your prayer list, but I've been diagnosed with cancer twice in my life, and been through chemotherapy and all the negatives associated with cancer. But I want to tell you, my heart has never been broken in my life like it was this last week. As I sat over the bed with my dad and my hero, the man that I look up most to in my life, and he looked at me with a blank stare, "Who are you? I want to go home." He was living in things that happened 35, 40 years ago in his life. He wanted to go see his mom and dad. He said, "They're in the other room, and you're keeping me from going there. They've been dead for 30 years. And my heart was just broken in my chest. And I stayed in his room with him around the clock for 3 days. And it was my job to put the oxygen back on him when he would pull the tubes off. And I got to be honest with you, about 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning every night, that was the loneliest time that I've ever spent. Sleep evaded me, and he was so not my dad. But in the midst of that loneliness, I got to tell you, I don't tell you any of this story to make you feel sorry for me. I'm sure that my dad is going to be fine. But I want to underscore the fact that whatever you face, I have found through experience that grace is full and free for every situation. And that's what grace is for.
Is there something in your way? A battle you can't win? And do you struggle day to day with thoughts of giving in? There's no reason for despair. He has walked this way before, with compassion flowing free. He's there for you and me. That's what grace is for. When all hope fades away and prayers are only words, just reach out in faith and know
He's already heard.
He'll mend your wounded heart. Answers just won't come, and your soul cannot be still. When it's all been said and done, rest in the Father's will. There's a multitude sins covered by the blood that pours, blood that cleanses every stain so that none remain. That's what grace is for. When all hope fades away,
His name is Scott Howard. He is also, are you glad to see him tonight? Give him a welcome. Scott, I told you Glenn was from West Monroe, Louisiana. Scott is also from West Monroe, Louisiana. Yeah. Now, we did not plan it that way. They didn't even know each other that well. They were not in a group together. It just was a coincidence that it worked out that we'd have two guys in the same group from the same hometown. Actually, what happened, they were having a sale on quartet men that day when we were going through. You buy one, you get one free. And guess who the freebie was?
You get what you pay for.
Scott is an incredible baritone. When we did have a model of what we wanted a baritone to be, in a big, rich, full, pleasing voice, but more than his voice, he's just the glue that holds this group together. He's one of those guys that you're standing around looking, waiting to go on or waiting to do something. He'll find something to wipe off or stack or fold, and he's a worker. And we love Scott. I've known him for 20 years, and didn't ever dream that God would work it out so that Scott would be in the same group with us, but we are so thankful for the blessing of him in our group. We weren't sure that we wanted to hire him. To be honest with you, I told a true story about Glenn. I'm going to tell it. The true story about Scott is he was pretty famous as a kid. They did the Today Show, and Good Morning America came to his school and brought their cameras and did a little story on him, a little vignette kind of, you know. He was the only 17-year-old that year to graduate from the fourth grade. And so he was the only graduate of the fourth grade that year that gave his teacher a ride to school. No. You know,
Roger, don't tell these people that. This is my first time out here.
Right.
And they don't know any better but to believe you when you say something. You tell stories about these guys, and it's true. But when you tell them something like that about me, they're going to believe it.
What's your point?
You say that little thing about 17 years old in the fourth grade, and that's just not right, and it makes them look at me like I'm some kind of...
ignorant. he puts the ig in ignorant,
no,
I'm
telling you. You say that, and they're going to believe that. They'll think that you actually believe that I am ignorant. You need to tell them different.
What's your point?
Now, you've already told them we've been friends for 20 years.
Right.
And you need to explain to these folks
that
you don't think that I'm ignorant.
Buddy, I put it to you like this. I think you're close to ignorant.
Well, how about now?
I hope y'all enjoy Scott Howard's farewell performance with Legacy 5 tonight. I tell you what, since you're so feisty, let's do a quartet song. These folks love quartet four-part singing. This is one called Ever Since He Came, features Scott.
My life was in shackles, my spirit broken down. The dreams I'd once soared, I'd come crashing to the ground. But when the Savior came knocking and when I let him in, he picked up the pieces, made me over again.
Ever since he came.
The sea. His voice set the compass on the face of the deep. But when I knelt at the altar and from sadness I cried, his hand gently wiped every tear from my eye. Ever since he came,
since Jesus came and pardoned every sin,
I'm not the same.
I'm not the same. No, I've been born again.
I'll tell the world.
No,
I've been born again. I'll tell the world.
remember the...
All right.
I remember the first time that we came here with the Cathedral Quartet, it was like a rock concert. You folks were crazy, you know, you were just... I know that a lot of you are Baptists. How many of you Baptists we got in the crowd tonight? That's what I thought. Y'all ain't no Baptist that I ever grew up around. Y'all are some kind of turbo Baptist or something. You've got some kind of California blood in you or something. I don't know what the deal is. In my church where we grew up, or I grew up, we were against everything. You didn't hoot and holler like y'all have hooped and hollered out here tonight, and you didn't have basically fun. You know, you didn't do that at our church. If it wasn't on the bulletin, we didn't do it. Our little secretary one time, we just had one secretary, she was part-timer, and she forgot to put dismiss on our bulletin one Sunday. We sat there till 3 p.m. waiting for somebody to figure out what to do. Finally had a deacon's meeting and convened that it would be all right to dismiss in order. We had a guy, I'm telling you, it was pitiful. We were against everything that way. If any new sin came up, we could say we was always against that one too. We didn't have drums in our church. We didn't have, because they were of the devil. We didn't, if you'd have tried to play a drum in our church, you'd have burst into flames. We didn't have stringed instruments because they were played in honky-tonks, you know. I wish you could have seen the head deacon the day I took him over and raised the lid up on the piano. He said, "They strings in that thing." Like they had a heart attack. We had a guy visit us from up north one summer Sunday morning, and he didn't get the memo about us being quiet in our church. From the time that you walked in the door of our church, you didn't open your mouth except to sing. That includes saying amen. You were blessed quiet, you know. And he didn't get the memo, and he's sitting down on the front row. And during the preacher's sermon, our preacher was a godly man, and he preached right out of the Word of God just as hard and strong as he could. And right in the middle of the sermon that Sunday morning, the visitor, the Yankee, hollered out at the top of his lungs, "Praise God!" You could have heard a pin drop. The head usher went over to him and said, "Sir, we don't do that at our church. You're going to have to be quiet." The guy said, "I just had the Holy Spirit." Usher said, "You didn't get him here. Now be quiet." But I'm glad it's not that way here tonight. I'm glad that we can feel the joy unspeakable and full of glory. Amen? Those old quartet songs, they're full of joy like that. People ask for them everywhere we go. And there was a lady walked into the table, Scott, when I was coming in earlier, and she asked us if we would do this song. No, little Scott. We asked us if we'd do this song. We haven't done it very often. And I asked Tony if he knew it. It's called "You Better Run." It's on our new album. Tony knows
it. Let her do it.
No, don't.
She's a ticket buyer. Can we take a, wherever you are, can we take a rain check? Because this has 3 verses on it. I don't think I can remember the verses.
No, you can
do
it. It doesn't matter. They want to hear the song.
We shouldn't rehearse. It's not professional. No,
I'm telling
we shouldn't.
You, look.
I'll do it.
How many folks ever saw The Statesman and Blackwood Brothers? Let's see your hands. Yes. This is out of their songbook. It's called "You Better Run."
Let the Statesman do it.
No, I think they're all dead. Now be quiet.
Who starts it?
You do. Pardon?
Give me my note.
That's the one you hit every night, pal. I'm sorry.
You better run.
You better run on to meet your Maker.
You better run.
You better run on to meet your Lord.
You better run.
If you can see Him some morning,
you better
run to meet Him in the morning.
The day will come, sometimes there'll be no more. Some will never make that heaven sure. And if you want to reach that happy land, you've got to
hurry, hurry, join that Christian band.
You better run.
You better run on to meet
oh,
your Maker.
You better run.
You better run on to meet your Lord.
You better run.
If you would see Him some morning,
you better
run to meet Him in the morning.
You have heard the message has been told, how the streets are paved. purest gold. The walls of jasper, gates are made with pearl. You know there's
nothing like it in this whole wide world.
You better run.
You better run on to meet your Savior.
You better run.
You better run on to meet your Lord.
You better run.
If you will see Him some morning,
you better run,
run to meet Him in the morning.
I just wanted y'all to hear my backup singers. You like them?
You can't sit around and wonder why. Can't keep saying someday by and by. Now's the time to really raise your voice. You know you
won't have to worry if you make him your choice.
You better run.
You better run on to meet your Maker.
You better run.
You better run on to meet your Lord.
You better run.
If you can see him some morning.
You better
run to meet him in the morning.
You better
run to meet him in the morning.
This young man needs no introduction.
Thanks, Roger.
Scott Fowler is his name. He was with the Cathedrals, you know, for 10 years. He's my best friend. Scott's my best friend in the world. He's now my business partner, and he's my
hero.
No, that wasn't a word that was oozing to my brain right there, Scott. Scott is, he has been enthralled with politics, let me tell you. Now, he loves it. That's his hobby. He really watches all those old shows, The O'Reilly Factor, Hannity and Combs, Meet the Press, Get Depressed. He watches all. Let me tell you something. I feel sure that if God hadn't called him into Southern gospel music, Satan would have called him into politics. Scott, why don't you just share a word and sing the song we've had a request for you to sing tonight. Basically, it's our statement of faith. We laugh and we have a wonderful time, and we have more fun than anybody should be able to have and get paid to do it. But the truth is, we are very serious tonight about telling you that Jesus is right for whatever's wrong in your life. You will not find the answers to life's problems here tonight during this concert. Within Legacy 5, we have nothing to offer you. We are just all sinners saved by grace. But we represent one who has life and life abundantly for you tonight. And Scott's got a song that he sings incredibly. People have asked for tonight. And just why don't you just share what this song means to you, or whatever you want to sing. I don't care. Sing whatever you'd like. I'll just go over here and collect my thoughts while you're getting ready.
That won't take long.
No.
Well, I tell you what, Roger wouldn't take the time to do this properly for himself, but I know that you're loved here too. Aren't you glad to see Roger Bennett tonight? I mean, I think everybody would be disappointed if they left tonight and didn't get to hear you play one. Would you play one for us?
Yeah, I'd be glad to. You want a fast one or a slow one? Fast one.
Okay. Yeah, get it over with.
Just farewell performances all over the place tonight, isn't it?
Roger! That's great, Roger. You obviously know what a great pianist Roger Bennett is. You're finding out what a great singer he is, but a lot of you might not be familiar with what a great songwriter that Roger is. Roger has written some incredible songs down through the years, and Roger, believe it or not, has some humility about him, and he wouldn't tell you these things because he doesn't want to come across as someone who's braggadocious, but I'm real proud of Roger, especially his writing and what it's meant to people all over the country. The great song that he wrote a few years back called Healing was honored with a Dove Award for Gospel Music Song of the Year last year. Yeah. Roger, you have a unique ability to write a song and speak your heart, and your music somehow touches the hearts of everybody who hears that. That is truly a gift. And I remember when George and Glenn came to us on the bus and told us that they were going to sing for another year, basically to tell everybody goodbye and thank you and that they loved you. And I remember they were here last year, and they did that all across the country. And they told us they were going to do that 12 months from that day. And so after that conversation, they left the bus and left me and Roger there by ourselves. And Roger grabbed me and took me to the back of the bus. And he said, "Scott, what in the world are we going to do?" I said, "Well, Roger, I mean, we've got to come up with something. We both love quartet music. You know, maybe we should think about, you know, putting together a group and just sticking together. We're best friends." And Roger confessed to me that night that he's never really wanted to do anything else. Is this accurate to say you've never really wanted to do anything else except what you're doing, playing, writing, and singing Southern gospel music? I told Roger that night that I knew that I was living the desire of my heart. I've never wanted to do anything else. We both agreed that night that neither one of us wanted to work.
I am against it.
That's right.
I tried it a day and a half and hated it. I just couldn't stand it.
You tried work a day and a half?
A day and a half, yeah, I did. That's the only job I ever had.
What'd you do?
I'm from Strawberry, Arkansas, you know.
Right.
I worked at the Strawberry Municipal Zoo for a day and a half.
Strawberry has a zoo?
Well, it did have. It wasn't like I quit or anything. They had to shut it down.
Confused.
Yes, everybody got laid off.
What happened?
Well, the chicken died is what happened. That'll mess up your exhibit, you know. And I had such good memories, you know. It was during Christmas time, and I don't know, it's just, I can just still see him. They used to put a little white beard on his beak. Call him Saint Chick. Now that's a Christmas sights and sounds spectacular right there, buddy.
I was trying to say something serious.
Well, that's serious if you like Saint Chick, I'm telling you.
Do you have any other tidbits of personal trivia you'd like to share with us before we move on?
No, but if I do, you'll be the first to know.
Shortly after that, Roger came back to me and he said, "Scott, I know that George and Glenn are not going to ever go back into the studio and record, and I have just written a song that I want you to hear." And Roger, you said it earlier, but I want to reiterate what I appreciate so much about Roger's music that he writes is that he unashamedly proclaims the gospel in his music. He doesn't water it down. He's not afraid to just tell it like it is. I think we need more music like that, to be honest with you. See, I believe that if we leave here tonight and someone were to catch us in the parking lot and say, "What exactly is it that you Christians believe?" I think we ought to be able to tell them. We believe it all. Cover to cover. Nothing in the Word of God we don't believe. If you're a little vague, if you're a little shady about what you think Christians believe, if you don't hear anything else tonight, I want you to listen to this song. Because you can leave knowing what it is that you as a Christian believes if you'll just listen to the words in Roger Bennett's great new song. It's simple but profound. It says, "The two words of my heart, Lord, are this: I believe."
Yes.
Do we have any believers in the church tonight?
I believe that God made the universe in just the span of 6 days. And I believe that Noah built a mighty boat that floated safe on the waves. And I believe that Daniel slept his cares away on the floor of the lion's den. And I believe that the word of God is sure and points our hearts to him.
I believe from Genesis to Revelation, yes, Lord, I believe
that your word is sure, your love is pure, your grace I now receive.
The two words of my heart, Lord, I believe.
If you're a believer, just say, praise the Lord.
I believe that Mary had a baby boy, but Joseph was not his dad. And I believe that Jesus lived a perfect life.
Yes, he did.
No one else ever has. And I believe that he died on the rugged cross to pay for all of my sins. And I believe that early on the third day, my Savior rose again.
I believe. Genesis to Revelation, yes, Lord, I believe
that your word is sure, your love is pure, your grace I now receive.
The two words of my heart, Lord, I believe.
I believe. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. When this life is but a memory, God's Word will still stand.
From Genesis to Revelation, yes, Lord, I believe that your Word is sure, your love is pure, your grace I now receive. The two words of
God bless you. We believe it all. We believe it from Genesis all the way over to the maps. And I believe the maps too. You guys are sophisticated city people, obviously. Right? And you've got great taste, or you wouldn't be here tonight, right? But yet you still want to hear him play the piano.
Yeah.
Play the piano.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, music lovers. Yes. The next number I'm going to play for you is one that I learned.
That's what a good sound man will do for you,
yeah,
right there.
I think it's time you meet our sound man. Can you turn the house lights on and let me introduce you to Kevin Rallion? This is Kevin Rallion up here in the sound booth. Take a bow, Kevin. Kevin. And Kevin. Kevin is 21 years old. He is from Kent, Ohio. He is he's our resident Yankee. He has the hardest job in our group, trying to make us sound good every night in a different building, and he's doing a fabulous job. He is terminally and profoundly single.
Yeah.
And if you see him out at the record table tonight, you'll understand why he's profoundly.
That's what a good sound man will do.
He is also soon to be unemployed. All right, well, it's request time at the old Roundup show at Shadow Mountain. And you've asked, yeah, we got a few requests.
I got a few, several.
You got several requests?
I had several requests. But I think we still ought to go ahead and sing some more anyway.
$14,000 comedians out of work. He's trying to be funny. Here's the first one. It says, the world will hear my voice. Jesus saves.
The church has been silent while the world raised its voice. In loud and angry tones, they took the lead. But all across creation, there's rumbling in the hills as the chosen ones of God stand up to make His message known. I've got to shout it from the housetops, proclaim it from the mountaintops, tell the world around me Jesus saves. I have made my choice, I'm gonna make a joyful noise. World will hear.
Good news, amen.
The rocks and hills were ready to proclaim the Master's might, but the Spirit of the Lord said they should wait. You see, God knew His children were ready to march on and proclaim His word throughout the land and seal the devil's fate. But the world still tells us daily that God is not alive, and salvation's plan is just a fairy tale. But their lies gon' change the truth, that Jesus died for you, and the word says His returning could happen any day. And I've got to
shout it from the housetops, proclaim it from the mountaintops, tell the world around me Jesus saves. I have made my choice, I'm gonna make a joyful noise. The world will hear my voice, Jesus saves. We have heard the joyful sound. Jesus saves, Jesus saves.
is not a mother, sister, friend, or brother, loves the way that Jesus can. He proved his love for me when he died on Calvary. He gave his life for fallen man.
His love's
a boundless love, and it reaches down and touches.
How'd you like that a cappella music there, Rods?
Just goes to prove what I've always known. A cappella is an old Latin word for of the devil. That's kind of sickening, actually.
Oh,
They do too many more like that, and they could go a cappella, and I'd be out of work. The tomb is still empty where Jesus once lay. There's no other like it to this very day. No one could explain it, but they knew it was true. He rose from the dead like he said he would do. Now he is gone,
gone.
Jesus has risen, ascended to heaven, to the Father's right hand. He locked death away in eternity's prison. The grave has been conquered forever. Let's do it again. Amen. He is gone,
gone.
Jesus has risen, ascended to heaven, to the Father's right hand. He has locked death away in eternity's prison. The grave has been conquered forever. Amen. That old grave has been conquered forever. Amen. He's gone.
Yeah, you boys didn't know it. I can't believe that.
And best for a world.
my trophies.
To my trophies.
And I will cling.
Victory in Jesus' name.
Sing when we've been there 10,000 years.
Imagine what heaven will be like. My finite brain and my imagination is so tiny compared to what God has created that it boggles me to think of it. When I flew out to meet the guys after being with my dad, I flew from Nashville to Boise, Idaho, and changed planes in Phoenix and then flew to Boise. And as I flew from Phoenix to Boise, Nashville to Phoenix, we went over the Grand Canyon.
That's a first for me. I'd never seen the Grand Canyon. We didn't have no Grand Canyon in Strawberry. We had a hole in the ground, but that was for old tires that were wore out. And when I looked out of the plane from 32,000 feet at this magnificent creation that God created, and I saw the thousands that looked like colors in the different levels of the ground, even from that many miles in the air, it took my breath away with its beauty. And I think, like most Christians, when we're confronted with something bigger than ourselves like that, we tend to think about the majesty and the wonder of God. And it started entering my mind what heaven really must be like. See, we believe it all. We believe that when the Bible says that eyes have not seen and ears have not heard, neither has it entered into the heart of man what God has prepared for those who love him. That's pretty heavy words. My grandma went there last November, Thanksgiving. The weekend I was re-diagnosed with cancer, my grandmother died after an 8-year battle with all kinds of sicknesses. She had begged God to let her die for years. For probably 3 or 4 years, she had asked God to take her, and God chose to leave her for a reason. She was a heroic woman. You'll never see her on a Gaither video. She will never be any famous person in this world. She never traveled, with the exception of 2 or 3 times, outside of the 60-mile radius of Strawberry, Arkansas. She was a heroic woman. She raised 27 foster children after she turned 60. She was a heroic woman. And one time when her world had shrunk to the recliner and the hospital bed that was in her room, that's what her world was. We were all lifting her up. It was Easter time, and she couldn't move, and we were taking her from her recliner to put her in her bed, and she was shaking, so trembling, so bad. And she looked over at my wife, and she said, "Debbie, honey, when I go, please don't cry for me." She said, "I'm so ready to go. I'm so ready to see Jesus. I'm so ready to be finally home." I wrote this song trying to imagine what heaven really must be like in those first few moments of consciousness when we realize that we are finally and safely home. I hope it ministers to you. Laughing like children at the foot of the throne, praising the Savior who brought us safe home, raising and adoring his ever-blessed name, the great Lamb of Calvary forever the same. We are home,
we are home.
Safely home.
Yes, we are home.
The sacrifice given, my sins all forgiven,
Calvary has won, we are home.
Lived in this place not our own, occupied country, the enemy's throne, never belonging and so out of place, constantly striving to finish the race. But listen now.
Now we are standing as trophies of grace,
anxiously waiting a glimpse of his face. The veil has been lifted, the glass has been cleared. With loud hallelujahs, the King has appeared, and we are home.
We are home.
Safely home.
Yes, we are home.
Oh, the sacrifice given, my sins all forgiven. Beautiful heaven must be.
Sweet home of the happy and free.
Fair haven
of rest for the weary.
Lord, I'm weary.
How beautiful heaven must be.
We are home.
We are home.
sins all forgiven.
Calvary has won.
We are whole.
We are whole.
We are whole.
We are whole.
Yes, we are whole.
We are whole.
We are whole.
Calvary has won.
We are whole.
Before we go, so many of you have asked us for this song. This will be our benediction tonight. I think about Jesus dying for us, and I remember at my grandma's house, she had a picture of him hanging on the cross, and you've probably seen the picture. It's an old, old painting of Jesus on the crucifixion day, and he's hanging on the cross with his arms outstretched. There's no blood around the wounds. The nails are just kind of painted in his hands, and his face is peaceful and serene, and he's hanging on the cross. I'm sure that the author and the artist of that painting meant to be respectful to our Lord, but there was nothing easy about the death on the cross. They didn't even have the word excruciating before Calvary. The word excruciating was invented to describe what the crucifixion was like. They put him in that old dark tomb. He laid there for 3 days quietly, but on the morning of the third day, something started moving around in that tomb. Jesus' eyes snapped open. Bible says he raised up. And the Bible went to great pains to tell us that he folded the napkin that was laying over his face and laid it down beside of him before he left. I didn't know until just a few weeks ago now. A friend of mine told me that the reason that Jesus folded the napkin was very symbolic. The Jewish people, when they were eating at a table and they were getting ready to leave, if they weren't coming back, they threw the napkin in the seat and they left. But if they had every intention of returning, they would fold the napkin neatly and lay it in their seat. Jesus has every intention of returning. When he walked out of the tomb, I'm amazed. That's good preaching, Roger. Good preaching. When he walked out of the tomb, the stone had been rolled away from the door. Here's another little tidbit for you from me. The stone was not rolled away from the door of the tomb to help Jesus get out. It's absurd to think that the Lord of the universe needed any help getting out of the tomb after God had raised him from the dead. There ain't enough rock in the world to hold Jesus in that tomb if God said come out. The reason the stone was rolled away from the door was so that you and I could look inside and see that he was not there, that the tomb was empty, and he was always and forever our all-time, undisputed, undefeated champion of love. Hallelujah.
Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention? I want to introduce to you in this corner of the good and the right stands a champion robed in white. His height exceeds the heavens, his weight outweighs the world, his reach reaches everywhere, his aid is evermore. He is higher than the highest, greater than the grave. No one will ever take his crown away. He is more mighty than the mightiest. He reigns from above. He's the all-time undisputed, undefeated champion. His hometown to enter this arena to raise his hands in victory for me. But an angry crowd crucified this king wore their crown.
Yes.
And they gladly watched the champion go down. But I will never count him out, for I am a witness of
the day he rose.
The day he rose to reclaim his title,
champion.
The champion of love.
He is higher than the highest.
He is greater than the great.
No one will ever take his crown away.
He is more mighty than the mightiest.
He reigns.